On behalf of Vivekananda Study Circle, a very warm welcome to all present here, especially our new friends on the campus. I start with a brief introduction about the Vivekananda Study Circle, which at IAC works with the objective of providing opportunity and guidance to interested youth to acquire a clear understanding of life, values, and culture in the light of life and teachings of Swami Vivekananda. To this effect, we students of IAC meet every week to read and discuss the message of Swami Vivekananda and Indian philosophy in the light of modern thoughts and modern needs. We'll start with the session with Shanti Mantras.
Om Ishvaro Gururatmeti मूर्ति भेदा विभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्त देहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः ओम सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहे तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहे ॐ शांति शांति शांति
वी आर वेरी ग्लैड टू प्रेजेंट द टॉक इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ ब्रह्मचर्य फॉर अ मीनिंगफुल लाइफ बाय स्वामी कीर्ति प्रदानंद जी महाराज स्वामी स्वामी जी इज अ मॉन्क ऑफ रामकृष्ण ऑर्डर and is currently serving as a registrar of Ramakrishna Mission, Vivekananda Educational and Research Institute, RKM Veri. He joined the order in 2004, after which he has served the order in various capacities. He was a coordinator of the Value Education Cell at Belur Math for 3 years and taught at Ramakrishna Mission Vivekananda College, Chennai for 5 years before joining RKM Veri. Maharaj Ji holds an MA English and MCOM degree from the University of Rajasthan and completed his MBA from IGNU, New Delhi. Now I request Swamiji to take over and start the talk. Question answer session will be conducted at the end of the talk. Please keep your microphones muted throughout the talk. Welcome Swamiji, please go ahead.
Thank you.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Om Janonim Saradam Devim रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयो श्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः नमः श्रीयतिराजाय विवेकानन्दसूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे A very good morning to all of you. My namaskars to all the members of this enlightened audience who have joined this meeting online, where we shall be discussing a profound subject that is of particular relevance to those few individuals who appreciate and strive to lead a higher life, a meaningful life, a life that is different from being engaged in mere hedonistic activities. The subject matter of our discussion will be importance of brahmacharya for a meaningful life. I am thankful to the members of the Vivekananda Study Circle at the Institute of the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, to host this virtual meeting. It's really very heartening to see that some of the best minds from a premier institution of India have come together and form this study circle in the name of Swami Vivekananda with the objective of understanding higher values of life as taught by Swami Vivekananda. I do not know how many of you are aware of this fact that the institution where you are studying in a way owes its origin to Swami Vivekananda. In 1893, when Swami Vivekananda went to Chicago for participating in the Parliament of Religions, he began his journey from Bombay on 31st May 1893. He sailed to America via China, Japan, and Canada. In his journey from Yokohama to Vancouver, he sailed in the ship Empress of India. In the same ship, Sir Jamshedji Tata was also traveling. They met together and had long discussions. Swami Vivekananda inspired Sir Jamshedji Tata to start an institute in India to impart fundamental science education and to promote science research. The result of the dialogue between the two great minds and great sons of India is the present Indian Institute of Science where you are studying. Okay, so let us now enter into the subject of our discussion, importance of Brahmacharya for a meaningful life. I shall spread my talk broadly under these five sections. In the first section, we will deal with the general meaning of Brahmacharya, and we will also go for the analysis of this term. In the second section, we will deal with a comparison between freedom from the senses as against freedom of the senses. In the third section, we shall discuss about the higher faculties of the human species that differentiates human beings from the subhuman species, and also what should be the goal of a human life. In the fourth section, we shall deal with the topic of mind and its control, and also try to understand the mind and the way it functions. And in the final section, we shall discuss about the necessity of Brahmacharya for a meaningful life, and also some practical means that can help us in the practice of Brahmacharya. So I now enter into the first section, that is what Brahmacharya means. The general meaning of Brahmacharya is self-restraint or self-control over one's senses. The core component of this self-control being the control of the sexual instincts, the carnal desires, thoughts, and acts. So Brahmacharya means a total self-discipline of the inner life, beginning with moral purity, the control of all the senses, control of the mind, and control of sexual instincts, desires, thoughts, and acts. If we analyze the term Brahmacharya, Brahmacharya is what a Brahmachari is supposed to practice. Now, who is a Brahmachari? Brahmani charati iti Brahmachari. One who constantly dwells on Brahman is called a Brahmachari. Brahman means the ultimate reality, and charati means dwelling on. So, Brahmani charati iti Brahmachari. One who constantly dwells on Brahman, the ultimate reality, is called a Brahmachari. Based on the Sanatana Dharma, there are different lifestyles and duties to be performed according to the four ashramas, that is four stages in life: Brahmacharya ashrama, Grihastha ashrama, Vanaprastha ashrama, and Sannyasa ashrama. The first stage of life is called Brahmacharya. It is the stage of a student. Here, the individual is taught to practice perfect self-control. It is the period of preparation and training. The duty of a Brahmachari is to lead a celibate life based on simplicity, chastity, austerity, and obedience. A Brahmachari is one who leads a life of strict discipline and study, and who always practices self-control, keeping in aim the highest truth. And the dharma that needs to be followed by a Brahmachari is called Brahmacharya Dharma. Here by dharma, I do not mean religion. By dharma, I mean here the rules of conduct, the daily duties, and the observances. Basically, under the dharma of Brahmacharya, all the observances of Yama and Niyama come. I hope you are all aware of Yama and Niyama. I would just very briefly mention them. Yama are the ethical rules that need to be followed by a brahmachari and can be thought of as moral imperatives. There are five components of Yama, which are Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, and Aparigraha. Ahimsa means non-violence. Satya is truthfulness. Asteya is non-stealing. Brahmacharya is self-restraint. And Aparigraha is non-possessiveness. Now, Niyama are the virtuous habits, behavior, and observances that ought to be done by a brahmachari. The five components of Niyama are Shaucha, Santosha, Tapas, Swadhyaya, and Ishwara Pranidhana. Shaucha is purity, cleanliness of mind, speech, and body. Santosha is contentment. Tapas is austerity. Swadhyaya is study of scriptures. And Ishwara Pranidhana means contemplation on the Supreme Being. Now a question arises. Why is it necessary to lay so much emphasis on the control of the senses and the control of the mind? The answer is twofold. One, nothing substantial can be achieved in life without perfect control over the senses and the mind. And two, it is the inherent tendency of the senses to be outward going and pleasure seeking. And it is the nature of the mind to be restless. So in order to tame them, conquer them, a special effort is necessary. The Katha Upanishad gives us a wonderful reason as to why are the senses always outgoing. It says, Paranchikhani vyatrinat swayam bhuhu tasmat parak pashyati namtar atman kashchit dhiraha pratyagatman aikshat avrata chakshuhu amritatvam icchan. The creator, the self-born Lord, created the sense organs, including the mind, with an inherent defect. What is the defect? They all have an outgoing tendency. The eye, the ear, the nose, the tongue, and the skin. All of them have a tendency to be outward going. Therefore, a man perceives only things outwardly, but not the inward self. Only a certain section of wise men who are desirous of a higher life, they turn the senses and mind inward and realize their true divine nature. In the evolution of the sense organs, from the simple unicellular organisms to the complex multicellular human body, there is a gradual increase of awareness. But this awareness is awareness of the external environment only. Knowledge at the level of the sense organs is always knowledge of the external world. In a human being, the cerebral system, though capable of experiencing higher visions and pursuing nobler aims, still largely functions at the sensate level in the case of most people. These higher visions and noble aims, which raise man to the moral and spiritual level of existence, proceed from a dimension of the human personality deeper than the sensate level. Progress at the human stage of evolution is measured in terms of the emergence of the spiritual man through inner discipline. Those who pursue only external pleasures are just merely candidates to humanity. They are not human yet, in the real sense of the term. Now we move on to the next section. where we shall discuss a very interesting point. Comparison between freedom from the senses versus freedom of the senses. The term freedom from the senses denotes the freedom of the self from the outgoing pull, temptations of the sense organs. One gets this freedom from the senses if one is able to fully keep the sense organs under perfect control. Gaining freedom from the senses makes a person the master of his or her senses. On the other hand, freedom of the senses denotes giving a free run to the sense organs to feed upon the various sense objects indiscriminately. Freedom of the senses will lead a person to be a slave of the senses. In day-to-day life, we need to make a choice between two mutually exclusive situations. The preferable option called Shreya and the pleasurable option called Preya. Shreya and Preya. Shreya is the preferable option and Preya is the pleasurable option. The Kathopanishad puts it beautifully. Anyat shreyonya dutaiva preyah te ubhe nanarthe purusham sinitah tayoha shreya adadanasya sadhur bhavati hiyate arthat yau preyo vrinite. The term preya means that which is pleasant, immediately attractive, and the term shreya means that which conduces to true welfare, which is ultimately beneficial. Preya is happiness arising from organic satisfactions, arising from the titillation of the senses. If man considers this as the be-all and end-all of life, man abandons himself to a round of sensory stimulations. He loses his independence and even surrenders his selfhood, in which alone consists his being a human being. Getting struck in a round of pleasures, man falls away from the positive evolutionary direction, which is greater awareness and life fulfillment. He remains a biological organism and misses his spiritual direction and goal. Preya is therefore below ethics. Ethics begins when we part from Preya and enter the path of Shreya. From then on, man ascends from the organic to the mental dimension and gradually to the spiritual dimension of his being. In the Preya path, therefore, the self of man is submerged in the darkness of avidya, ignorance, spiritual blindness. And this darkness will begin to lift as he enters the Shreya path, which is the path of knowledge, spiritual awareness. Preya demands freedom of the senses. Shreya, on the other hand, demands freedom from the senses. All law and morality mean limitation of the sense-bound man in order to liberate the true self of him. They involve a distinction between man's lower life and higher life. So Shreya stands for human welfare in a fundamental sense, and Preya stands for self-sufficient hedonism, leading to stagnation of life at the physical level. Life under the Preya idea can never advance beyond its elementary forms, because there is a stifling of spiritual awareness by the tyranny of the immediate present, the lure of profit and pleasure. Shreya is characterized by farsight and foresight, whereas Preya is characterized by short sight, with the flowing stream of life arrested and getting stagnant. So we must strive to achieve freedom from the senses. I am free from the senses. they no longer can tempt me or make me a slave. And that can happen only by curtailing the freedom of the senses, restraining them and controlling them. Our next point of discussion is with regard to the higher faculties of the human species that differentiates human beings from the subhuman species. In what way human beings are superior from the other species? And what should be the goal in this human life? The human species, the human being, is the finest and the ultimate gift of the process of biological evolution. The process of evolution involves physical and biological evolution right from the single-celled amoeba till it reaches the human level. At the human level, the physical and biological evolution reaches its culmination and takes an inward turn. After we reach the human level, no more external evolution. Whatever evolution has to happen is to happen within, internally. The human species represents the pinnacle of glory of the entire evolution process. From here on, no more physical evolution. All growth and development has to be within, in the mental, intellectual, moral, and spiritual level. Now the question is, what differentiates the human species from the subhuman ones? Animals, for instance. It is the buddhi, the discriminative faculty. A human being is endowed with the faculty of discrimination, which aids in making the difference between the right and wrong, and to make the correct choice. All animals are instinct driven, completely slave to their sense organs. It is only at the human level that a being is capable of higher thinking. But simply having a human body does not make one a human being in the real sense of the term. The faculty of reasoning, which is a gift of creation, exclusively at the human level, when the process of evolution reached its pinnacle, that faculty of reasoning, that discriminative faculty, need to be developed to become a true human being. Running after sense pleasure is not the goal of human life. It is the goal of the animal kingdom, all creatures in the subhuman level. If we look around in the present day's world, we find there is an increasing impact of the Western value system on our society. We are at a rapid pace getting affected by the consumerist values and permissive culture of the West. A vast majority of the people in the present society are running after hedonistic pursuits and are following the Charvaka philosophy. The Charvakas, they had a very interesting philosophy. They said, Yavat jivet sukham jivet, ranam kritva ghritam pibet, bhasmi bhutasya dehasya punaragamanam kutaha. As long as you live, live happily, enjoy life, eat, drink, and make merry. Even if you can't afford to or don't have enough resources to enjoy, don't bother. Beg, borrow, or steal, but enjoy this life to the fullest extent as long as the body exists. Once the body is gone and it is consigned to flames, where is the question of rebirth? Now we have to think for ourselves. As the Charvaka says, if soul enjoyment and the pursuit of sense pleasures are the only things worth striving for in the human life, then what difference is there between animals and human beings? The goal of human life is freedom from bondage, freedom from ignorance, freedom from the overdominance of our sense organs on us. So long we do not strive for this freedom, and engage ourselves in hedonistic pursuits, we remain an animal, but in a human frame. There is a saying, Ahara Nidra Bhayamaitunam Cha Samanya Etat Pashubhir Naranam Dharmohitesham Adhikah Visheshaha Dharmena Heenaha Pashubhi Samanaha. Eating, sleeping, fear, and sex. These habits are common between a human being and an animal. It is the dharma, the inner conscience, the discrimination of what is right and what is wrong, that is the special quality of human beings. Without this dharma, human beings are in no way different to the animals. They're similar to the animals. Then what should human beings strive for? In the Gita, Bhagavan Sri Krishna says, Shaknoti iheiva yah sodhum prak sharira vimokshanat kama krodha udbhavam vegam sayukta sasukhi naraha. One who can withstand in this life, before the liberation of from the body, the current arising from lust and anger, he or she is a yogi. He or she is a happy human being. Shaknoti, whoever is careful. Ihaiva, in this very life, in this very body, not in some heaven. Sodhum, to withstand. Withstand what? Vegam, the tremendous current. What kind of current? Kamo krodho udbhavam, arising from kama and krodha. Kama is sensory craving and krodha is anger. These are powerful forces which can take you off your feet. It can destroy a whole life. That is the nature of this current. Therefore, those people who can withstand this tremendous current of kama and krodha here in this very life, before the death of this body. After death, nothing can be done. We can achieve this before death only. Prak means before. Sharira vimokshanam means liberation from the body. There is no question of any post-mortem achievement. Ihaiva, ihaiva. Here it is. Here itself, it has to be done. If you are able to do so, sayuktaha, he or she is a yogi. Sasukhi naraha, he or she is a happy human being. If genuine happiness is to be sought after, you have to achieve this particular strength to withstand the currents that take us this way and that way, make us mere slaves of various forces acting within ourselves. When we are enslaved, our freedom goes away completely. And without freedom, happiness and tranquility of mind is out of question. Youthful energy has to be disciplined to rise to higher levels. The energy gets lessened and lessened in old age. If water flows in a river, you can put a dam, create a big lake, make hydro channels for electricity generation as well as for agriculture. But if there is no water in the river, what is the use of putting a dam? So in old age, there is no energy. In youth, there is a tremendous energy. It is in the state of youth that we need this tremendous channelization of human energy. In our day-to-day life, we experience every minute we are subjected to these emotional energies of kama and krodha. We have to handle them and we have to do it ourselves. Nobody else can do it for us. This is what we have to try and achieve by our human efforts. This should be one of the constant goals of our human life. I now move on to the next section. That is understanding the mind and its functioning. In this section, we shall see how the outward going senses can be controlled through control of the mind. Controlling the mind is a subject of enormous relevance in today's modern world. We see in the modern times that people in all walks of life are struggling because of the restlessness of mind. One common complaint is that the mind is restless, ever fluctuating, excited, agitated, and is uncontrollable. And the result in extreme cases lead to depression, frustration, hypertension, and nervous breakdown. A question may naturally come: if the mind is so restless, can it really be tamed? Certainly it can be tamed, says the Gita emphatically. The mind can be tamed by proper training, and there is a technique for it. The problem of mind being not controllable is not new in today's modern world only. This problem is as old as humanity has been existing. In fact, Arjuna also faced the same problem, and he complained to Lord Krishna, saying, Chanchalam hi manah Krishna pramathi balavad dridham tasyaham nigraham manye vayoriva sudushkaram. Arjuna is putting forth the doubt which everyone has. He says, verily, O Krishna, the mind is very, very fickle. Chanchalam hi manah Krishna. He implies it is well known. So, chanchalam hi manah Krishna means it is well known that the mind is very fickle. Pramathi balavadridham. It pulls me powerfully this way, that way. He says, O Krishna, the mind is very restless, turbulent, strong, and obstinate. Tasyaham nigraham manye sudushkaram. Its control and its discipline I consider to be difficult. Vayo riva. Like trying to catch the air. Hearing this complaint of Arjuna, Lord Krishna replied, Asanshayam mahabaho manadurnigraham chalam abhyaseno tu kaunteya vairagyena chagrahyate. Lord Krishna says, you are right, Arjuna. This mind is very difficult to control. Sri Krishna accepts the description of the mind by Arjuna. He does not contradict it. He says, how we can yet manage to control the mind? Asanshayam, you are right. Without any doubt, manha durnigraham, mind is difficult to control. Chalam, it is constantly flickering. When Arjuna said, I find the mind difficult to control, Sri Krishna says, grahyate, it can be controlled. How? By two methods. Abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena chagrahyate. Through abhyasa and vairagya. By constant practice and a sense of detachment. The control of the mind can be done through constant practice and the spirit of renunciation of a mere sensate life. The power of constant practice yields amazing results. Even gentle water droplets repeatedly dropping on a hard surface like rock eventually erodes the rock in some years' time. That is the power of repetition. So, the control of mind can also be done through this abhyasa and vairagya. constant practice and the repetition of the right kind of activities done with a proper attitude. Further, Lord Krishna then gives the technique of how to control the mind. He says, Dhyayato Visayan Punsaha Sangasteshu Pajayate Sangat Sanjayate Kamaha Kamat Krodho Vijayate. Thinking of sense objects, sense pleasures, attachment to them is formed in a human being. From attachment rises a desire to possess, and from longing, anger emerges. Dhyayato Vishayan Punsaha. When you go on thinking, brooding over and over again about the sensory objects, the sensory pleasures, and you find them very attractive, then what happens? Sangasteshu Pajayate. The mind develops an attachment for them. I like it. First, I'm only seeing it. Then I've already got glued to it, attached to it. Then what happens? Sangat Sanjayate Kamaha. I must possess it. That desire comes. And the attachment that was created in the next step brings in the desire to possess that. So first, observing a thing, dwelling on it for long, then drawn by it, and then the desire to possess. And if people obstruct it, kamat krodho vijayate. Anger will come from desire. Then what happens? Krodhat bhavati sammoha, sammohat smriti vibhramaha, smriti bhranshat buddhinasho, buddhinashat pranashyati. Krodhat bhavati sammoha. When krodha or anger comes, sammoha, delusion comes. You forget your surroundings, you forget your own individuality, your family background, everything is forgotten in that state. From that anger, you develop delusion, sammoha. You have no clear thinking after that. Everything is confused. Then, sammohat smriti vibhramaha. Through that sammoha, you lose your memory of who you are and what you are, what is your background, etc. This way we go down. Krodhat bhavati sammoha, sammohat smriti vibhramaha. Smriti bhranshat buddhi nasho. When the smriti goes away, memory of our environment, memory of our identity, all this memory goes away, then what happens? Buddhi nashaha. That discriminative faculty, that reason which tells you what is good and what is bad, that discriminative faculty which guides you what to do and what not to do, completely goes away. And when that discrimination goes away, then what happens? Buddhi nashat pranashyati. You just perish. Because of buddhi nashaha, one perishes. Thus, step by step, we go down. Have you observed from where the entire problem started? What is the root cause? Dhyayato Vishayan Punsaha. It started from thinking on the sense objects, dwelling on them constantly. So we have to be very, very careful about the thoughts that we entertain in our mind. So observe the chain of events that take place. It begins at the thought level. Thinking of sense objects, that leads to attachment to those sense objects. That leads to desire to possess. If anybody obstructs, in the process of possessing it, anger comes in. Anger leads to delusion. Delusion leads to loss of memory. Loss of memory leads to the destruction of the discrimination faculty. And once discrimination goes, a person perishes. So, the control of the mind starts at the thought level. This is what we need to keep constantly in our mind. Okay, now let me share with you a beautiful imagery that is employed in the Katha Upanishad to illustrate about the functioning of the sense organs and the mind. Atmanam rathinam vidhi shariram rathamevatu buddhim tu sarathim vidhi manah pragrahamevacha. It is the imagery of a chariot in which the human body is considered to be a chariot. The sense organs are considered to be the horses. The mind, manas, is considered to be the, what you call, lagam, the bridle, the rein. And the buddhi, the discrimination faculty, is considered to be the sarathi, the driver. As the sarathi drives the chariot by controlling the horses with the help of the bridle, similarly, buddhi drives the human body by controlling the sense organs with the help of the mind. In this imagery, Yama, the lord of death, who happens to be the teacher in the Katha Upanishad, says, consider the human body as a chariot. But the chariot has no motive power in itself, neither has the human body. The chariot gets its motive power from the horses yoked to it. Similarly, the body gets its motive power from the sense organs consisting of the nervous system and the brain. The organs of perception and the organs of action convert the body into a center of the most dynamic activity in nature. But at the level of the senses themselves, this activity is mostly uncoordinated and therefore not fit for purposes beyond mere organic survival. This coordination is found at the human level in a new faculty called the manas or the mind. This manas is treated as on a level with the five sense organs of perception and sometimes referred to as the sixth sense organ also. So as I told earlier, in the imagery of the chariot, the rein stands for this manas. The reins is in whose hands? They are in the hands of the sarathi, the charioteer. The sarathi is the buddhi, the reason, the discriminative faculty. For life's journey to be successful, it is important to ensure that the initiative and control pass from the sense organs to the buddhi through the manas. This cannot happen unless the buddhi and the manas are trained and disciplined into their true forms. The true form of the manas, the mind, is its pure state when it is aligned with buddhi and ceases to be a mere appendage of the senses. The true form of the buddhi is its pure state as reason when it is independent of the mind and the sense organs. It then is possessed of discrimination and sound judgment. Such a buddhi is the best guide in life's journey. It denotes the fusion of intelligence, imagination, and will in their purest forms. Its impact on life is a wholesome one. When the sense organs dominate the journey, life remains at the gross stage, at the near animal level. Life's achievements are then measured in terms of mere titillations of the nerves and survival of the body. When the mind, the manas, which is by nature volatile, dominates the journey, life experiences erratic movements and intense fluctuations between luminous inspirations and low depression, between high moral and aesthetic levitations and low selfish and worldly gravitations. But when buddhi dominates the journey, life rises to the steady ethical and spiritual levels, tastes true freedom and delight, and achieves fulfillment through spiritual illumination. So we must always consciously use this faculty of buddhi, use our reasoning and discrimination in the decision-making process of our day-to-day life. So far, we have discussed a wide range of topics relating to the control of the sense organs, control of the mind, and various other aspects related to the concept of brahmacharya. Now, we move on to the fifth section, the last section of my talk, where we shall discuss about the necessity of brahmacharya for a meaningful life and some practical means as an aid to practice brahmacharya. Regarding the importance of brahmacharya, there is absolutely no doubt that for leading a higher life, a meaningful life, practice of brahmacharya is a prerequisite. It is of utmost importance. Please note here that when I say practice of brahmacharya, in this context, brahmacharya means control of the senses and the mind in general, and control of the sexual instincts, thoughts, and acts in particular. Swami Brahmanandaji Maharaj, who was the first president of the Ramakrishna Math and the Ramakrishna Mission, used to say, to secure the full development and vitality of the body, of the brain, and the mind, brahmacharya is very much essential. Those who observe strict brahmacharya develop a strong memory and a remarkable capacity of understanding things. By means of brahmacharya, a special nerve called medha nadi is developed, which brings about wonderful powers. Sri Ramakrishna himself used to say, one cannot attain anything in spiritual life without perfect chastity in thought, in word, and in deed. The extent of real chastity attained determines the whole progress of the individual. Now let us discuss about some practical means of how to practice brahmacharya. There is a remarkable book, Meditation and Spiritual Life, by Swami Yatishwaranandji Maharaj, in which he has mentioned some practical advices with regard to the practice of brahmacharya, which I am going to share with you. The solution for controlling the sex idea and to practice brahmacharya comes from three levels: physical level, mental level and the spiritual level. At the physical level, one has to be very careful in mixing with the people of the opposite gender. Young people, especially you students, should be very careful about your friendships. At this stage of your life, you are too young and emotional to recognize the true motives. Very often, sex hides under the cloak of duty. A thought may come, it is my duty to be kind to him or her. Immediately, you should analyze such thought. Invariably, you will find it is nothing but the sexual attraction coming in some nice garb and finding some nice excuses for your clinging to a certain person. Those who want to lead a life in higher plane must be discriminative in their approach when it comes to mixing with people of the opposite gender. At the mental level, first of all, make it a point never to give the enemy a frontal attack. There is an art of fighting with the senses and the mind. Never be too violent. Without first creating the fighting mood, if we want to overcome the senses by extreme violent methods, it may lead to a dangerous situation. Remaining in a lower mood, if we try to control ourselves in a violent manner without rising to a higher plane, this results in the most violent reactions, both physical as well as mental. So with an effort of the will, we should first raise the mind and create the higher mood. Once a higher mood is created, then with a little force, control of the senses and the control of the mind can be accomplished. Try to think thoughts which counter the sex idea. Through physical means alone, one will not be able to control the sex idea, which has its root deep within the personality structure. The most important point is to tackle the problem at the mental level. We find that imagination plays a dominant role in our life. There exists some connection between sex and the imaginative faculty in man. This connection often gets stronger through wrong associations. The mind should never be allowed to form wrong pictures and brood over them. This is possible only by the practice of producing counter thoughts. As is said in the Patanjali's Yoga Sutra, Vitarka Badhane Pratipaksha Bhavanam, to obstruct the thoughts which are inimical to yoga, contrary thoughts should be thought. This is an important technique. By constantly thinking good thoughts, the whole bad thought structure can be changed. If you go towards the east, automatically you go away from the west. So you have to make a conscious effort to think higher thoughts which are inimical to the sexual thoughts. That is a very important technique in controlling the sex idea. And another thing is, be aware of your mind's deceptions. You see, all temptations are mental. Usually, it is not what you do, it is what you think that is more troublesome. So take care of your imaginations. Be aware of how other people's vibrations affect your mind. Develop more and more high sensibility. Analyze what you feel and what you think in the company of others, whether they attract you or not. The moment there is any attraction or aversion, be on your guard. And another way is going beyond the male-female principle. For a male person, if any thought of any woman arises in the mind, associate it at once with the form of your own biological mother or the form of holy mother. Kill the sexual thought at once. As they say, nip it at the bud itself. And same is the case vice versa for the female person. Do not permit yourself to be in the company of the opposite gender mentally. Now let us see the solution for controlling the sex idea at the spiritual plane. Actually, you can never rise above the sex idea as a man by merely hating women or by fleeing from the world. Something more is needed. Even hatred is a kind of negative attraction. The only way to transcend sex consciousness is to see the divine in all men and women. But in order to cultivate this attitude, one should begin with oneself. It is not the woman who is outside that is dangerous for a man, but it is the man within, and vice versa. Do some Atma Chintan. Think that you are not this mere body-mind complex. You have a deeper dimension within. You are the self, the pure light of consciousness that is shining in all bodies. You are the eternally pure Atman. If you are able to fill your mind with this idea, then your whole personality will get colored by it, and your attitude and behavior is bound to change. Such a change is a fundamental need for a higher life. A change in our consciousness level, that is what is required. We should deliberately strive to shift our center of consciousness from lower centers to the higher ones. This is a very effective way to rise above the sex idea. So I think I have approached the threshold of the time given to me. So I would like to conclude this talk of mine with sharing with you all a few more practical hints which, implemented in the day-to-day life, can help you to go beyond the sex idea. One, a person intending to live a higher life must avoid these things: exciting food, oversleeping, overexercise, laziness, bad company, and impure conversations. Two, they should not accumulate more energy in their body than they can handle. If necessary, sometimes a reduction in the quantity of food or fasting can help in this regard. Three, there is a basic creative urge in all of us. If this is not sublimated and directed to higher channels, it tries to find expression in lower centers. We must try to employ ourselves in some or the other creative work and try to keep the higher center active. And finally, sadhu sangha, company of holy person. This is a great help in the practice of brahmacharya. Contact with pure-hearted people has a profound influence on struggling aspirants. If we do that, we'll gain some help in our pursuit of practicing brahmacharya. So with these points, I conclude this talk of mine with the prayer to the Almighty Lord that He showers His grace in abundant measures on all those individuals who are sincerely striving to lead a higher life, and that He guides all such sincere people so that they become successful in leading a noble life and are able to withstand the current arising from lust and anger and continue their journey towards achieving perfection and fulfillment in this life. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Tat Sat Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.
Thank you, Maharaj, for this wonderful talk. So I was making some notes during the talk, and will like say them out so that everyone can ask questions based on the entire talk. So first we studied the meaning of the word Brahmacharya, where you said Brahmani charati iti Brahmachari. So Brahmacharya, and then you talked about Brahmacharya Dharma, rules of conduct, daily observances, etc. We also discussed about freedom of the senses versus freedom from the senses, and studied the concept of Shreyas versus Prayas. And then we studied about the difference between human and subhuman species, and we concluded that buddhi, intelligence, or the faculty of reasoning is what differs or makes a difference between human and subhuman species. And then we studied about understanding the mind and its functioning. And then you talked about Abhyasa and Vairagya for under the topic of controlling the mind. And we also discussed how thinking about sense objects leads to attachments to sense objects and so on. And therefore, we saw how the problem starts from thinking about the sense objects, which is the root at all problem of all problems. And then we also discussed about chariot imagery. And then buddhi dominates. Buddhi should dominate the journey of our life, and then only the life can be stable. And then necessity of Brahmacharya for a meaningful life. And you said that, as Sri Ramakrishna and Swami Brahmananji also told, that practice of Brahmacharya is of utmost importance for a spiritual life. And you gave some practical advices, which are advices at the physical, mental, and spiritual plane, and some other practical hints too. So maybe we can now open the session for some question and answers. So anyone who has questions can raise their hands by using the option which might be coming on your lower right of the screen, and we will ask you to unmute and ask your question. You can also type your question in the chat box if that's more convenient. Okay. So Palash, yes, you can unmute your microphone and ask the question.
Thank you. Pranam Maharaj. Namaste. I am from Vivekananda Youth Circle, IIST Sipur. The question from my side is, what should be a daily life routine of a Brahmachari student?
Well, what should be a routine? There cannot be any hard and fast rule for that. It has to be a flexible one that suits you. For instance, when the exams are near, you would like to devote more time towards studies, compromising with some other aspects of your daily life. When you are relatively free, you can engage yourselves in some other pursuits. But in general, your routine should be such that you should not idle away time in worthless pursuits, in what you call filling your mind stuff with the garbage that is outside. And nowadays, with this internet, mobile, and what you call all those all these gadgets, Facebook, Twitter, it is very easy to get carried away. And once we are into this, what you call, using this phone, I think, how many of you use your phone for less than 15 minutes a day?
Like, no one, Maharaj, I think. None of us.
So much dependent we are on these modern gadgets. So, such unimportant things, if we are able to cut out from our daily routine and try to use our time and energy in productive causes, that would be more worthwhile. So accordingly, we can draft our routine and that suits best to us. I mean, there cannot be any hard and fast prescription for this.
Like Maharaj, I am saying that we should rise in Brahma Muhurta and don't eat too much in night, like that rule.
Yeah, if that is the best, is follow the rules of an ideal brahmacharya. Like a brahmachari life, as I discussed in my talk, that brahmachari ashrama, a little bit of austerity is required. So get up at least half an hour before sunrise. And after getting up, have a wash. And then try to meditate for some time. Try to calm your mind, think some higher, holy, noble thoughts. Spend some time in prayer. Pray to whichever God you believe in. And then start the activities of your daily life. In general, they say, have a breakfast like a king. And the lunch also you can have as much as you can. Not like a glutton, but as much as required. But dinner should be relatively lighter so that it is convenient for you to get up early in the morning. This is as far as the food habits are concerned. And it's a very, very good practice to get up early in the morning in the Brahma Muhurat, as you just mentioned.
Thank you, Maharaj.
So Maharaj, someone asked a question in the chat as to how to get up early in the morning related to the answer.
How to get up early in the morning? One way is the same mobile which you use, put an alarm there. And when it rings, you get up. Okay. Another way is you have to go to bed relatively earlier in the night. Nowadays, you know, students, they keep on remaining awake to late night. Of course, some do study. Some say, you know, I'm in my elements in the night only. So if you go to bed at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, then getting up before the Brahma Muhurta is practically impossible. So you have to decide that which routine suits you, studying early in the morning or late in the night. You know, there are two varieties of people, lark variety and owl variety. So the owl variety people, their minds are and brains are active in the night. So I have nothing to say about that. I mean, if you are getting quality time in the night and you are using it for productive purpose, then if that suits you, I have nothing to say about it. But if you have to get up early in the morning, then you have to go to bed early. It cannot happen this way that you sleep late and yet get up early and still remain fresh and active. That is a little contradictory, you know, proposition.
So, yes, someone has raised their hands. Go ahead and ask the question, Mukherjee.
Pranam Maharaj.
Namaste.
Yeah. Maharaj, my question was, is veg food compulsory for brahmacharya, or we can also have non-veg food? Means what are the food habits that we should adopt? Thank you.
Well, as far as food habits are concerned, I mean, there are no such strict regulations for that. You keep on taking pure food, sattvic food, but you keep your mind engaged in dirty thoughts, that's not going to help. You take non-veg food, but strive sufficiently to lead a good life. There's nothing harm in that. But certain foods are prohibited for a brahmachari, that is tamasic food, like garlic, onion. These things should be consumed as minimum as possible. But as far as leading a brahmachari's life is concerned, food is not the sole criteria. It is at what level you try to keep your mind, that is of paramount importance. Actually, by food, normally ahara is the word. Now, ahara we understand as food, but actually ahara means all the sensory impressions, all the inputs that we receive through our sense organs. We see a sight, we hear a sound. All these things are also inputs, not just merely the food. So coming to your question, as far as practicing brahmacharya is concerned, vegetarian food, if you are a vegetarian, it's good. You need not resort to eating non-vegetarian items. But from childhood, if you are used to eating non-vegetarian food, that doesn't mean that the doors of practicing brahmacharya are closed for you. It is not that way.
Thank you, Maharaj. Thank you.
So Maharaj, Veena R is asking, in all Vedanta talks, we always hear it is good to lead brahmacharya life. Then wouldn't it be good for all to lead this kind of life than being married?
Now, brahmacharya life means what? That we have to understand first. Brahmacharya means self-control, self-restraint. For married people, the rules are different. Sri Ramakrishna used to say, after the birth of one or two children, the husband and wife should live as brother and sister. So actually, brahmacharya means don't get indulged in the sense pleasures beyond a certain limit. Don't have a hedonistic attitude towards life. That is more important.
Okay, thank you, Maharaj. And there is one question by Lokesh Mohan, which I'm slightly changing and adding something. So he's asking, I would like to know if there are some pranayams or yogasanas which are more suitable for the practice of brahmacharya or which helps in brahmacharya. Are there any yogasanas or pranayams?
Well, pranayama helps in calming the mind to a certain extent. I mean, beyond that, I don't see it having much benefit as far as practicing brahmacharya is concerned. But it does help you to calm your mind, to get yourself stabilized before meditation. But as far as brahmacharya is concerned, you have to be careful what you think, what you dwell upon, and what you imagine. These things are important.
Okay, Maharaj. So, Venkat, Do you have a question? You can unmute yourself and ask.
Namaskar, Namaskar Maharaj.
Namaste.
It's a very wonderful talk. I have one question which we usually hear when following this Brahmacharya, the example from Bhagavad Gita, the charioteer example. So in the example where the charioteer is the Buddhi, Manas is the robe and the horses are the senses. So how to we have a discrimination in Manas and Buddhi, which is not physical by nature, in our, it's in the mind of our own. So what is the difference in the Manas and Buddhi, and how to achieve that level if we are not in that level?
Actually, here the problem is in translation. In English, they use the word mind, which we translate it as Manas. Now, when we say Manas, actually it is the Antahakarana, the inner instrument, which is further divided into four different faculties: Manas, Buddhi, Chitta and Ahankar. So Buddhi is Nishchayatmika. You zero upon a particular aspect. Before that, it's the oscillation. Manas is the oscillating faculty. Maybe, may not be, this or that. But when you fix your decision making, then it is the job of the Buddhi. So, and Ahankar is the ego. So Manas, Buddhi, Chitta and Ahankar, these are four faculties which form the Antahkaran, which is broadly called the mind in English. So it's the, actually the translation that is creating this confusion.
Okay, Maharaj, thanks.
Maharaj, I have a question.
Yeah.
So you told about Vairagya. So what is Vairagya? Which attitude is Vairagya?
Vairagya means, in a way, in a layman's language, I would say disgust towards the world. Sansar ke prati virag. So actually it should have twofold thing: Ishwar ke prati anurag and sansar ke prati virag. So I'm no more interested in this humdrum life, in the sense pleasures, in these activities of the world, and I have developed a love for God. So Vairagya means dispassion. I'm no more interested in this worldly pursuit, in the pursuit of the sense organs, and I am interested in something higher, something nobler. So that is Vairagya and Virag and Anurag.
Okay, Maharaj. And what does Anuraga towards God means?
What does?
Anuraga towards God.
Love for God. Love for God, love for higher life, love for realization, love for freedom, in any way you can put it.
Okay, okay. I have one more question. Mm-hmm. So you talked about keep yourself at higher centers. So like even while meditating, we do like focus on some centers which our guru told us. So is it something related to that, or is it like keep your mind on a higher plane?
No, it's basically keep your mind in a higher level of existence. Don't allow your mind to go towards the lower, towards your lower self, towards the animal instincts. Keep your mind at a level of higher thinking, nobler thinking, spiritual pursuits. That's the idea.
Okay, Maharaj.
So if you permit me, I have another meeting at 12:30.
Oh, okay, so okay.
Would like to, or any other question is there?
Maharaj, maybe there is one question from Abhik Bandhan. So would you like to unmute yourself and ask the question?
Pranam Maharaj.
Namaste.
So I have one question that so maybe due to the some spiritual thoughts or spiritual sadhana, someone might get find that their craving has got reduced. Okay, a craving.
What has got reduced?
Cravings.
Cravings, acha.
Okay, and but there are some some mental or physical defects also. Then under that kind of situation also, people feel no desire for cravings, either for food or for anything, any sense pleasures, anything. So is there any way to discriminate whether it is due to the physical or hormonal disbalance or mental disbalance, or due to some development in the spiritual path?
Well, if it is because of some development in the spiritual path, you can easily find it out. The person who has spiritually evolved will show in his life itself that he is somebody different. His interactions, his way of conducting himself in life, you can find out. And if it is a result of any physical or mental ailment, the conduct will be entirely different. So it's not just merely the cravings have gone. Now it's just like a beggar telling that, you know, I don't have any mohamaya. Now what do you have to renounce? For renouncing something, you must have something. So similarly, if you say you're at an old age, you have lost your teeth, you have lost your sense of appetite, and then you say that I have no more cravings for a good dish or this or that, then that is something different. But when you are in the prime of your youth, when you are healthy, when your mind is fully vigorous, and still you purposefully, you consciously strive and develop a sense of vairagya and say no to all these things, that is something different. That I think it's very easy to find out by observing their conduct, the behavior, the way they conduct themselves in life. You can able to distinguish whether it is a case of spiritual illumination or it's a case of and physical and mental ailment.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Thank you, Maharaj. Then we would like to conclude this session.
Yeah. So let us do it with the Shanti Mantra.
Yes, Maharaj.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Tat Sat. Shri Ramakrishna Arpanamastu.
Thank you very much, Maharaj.
So I thank you all. Namaskar.
Namaste, Maharaj. Pranam.